Good morning.
Good morning.
Our call to worship this morning is Psalm 103, verses 13 and 14.
The Lord is like a father to his children, tender and compassionate to those who fear him. For he knows how weak we are. He remembers we are only dust. Amen.
Amen. Welcome. Happy Father's Day to all the fathers out there. Happy Father's Day to all the fathers that are not out there, but are at their homes. So please wish them a happy Father's Day from us. There are cookies at the back. Some people wanted to take them before the service, but they are there for after the service. So after the service, everybody is welcome to take a package of cookies.
Or two.
Pardon me?
They take a package of cookies or even two if they want.
They can take two if they want.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I'm the last one to go out. I'm just, you know. Anyway, yes, one or two, whatever you wish. Because we will not be having coffee time today. Because it's Father's Day, a lot of people will not be staying, so therefore no coffee time today. But on that same note, there's a coffee sign-up sheet, which absolutely nobody bothered to sign last week, so therefore we have to do it again this week. It's on the counter downstairs. Please sign up so that... we can have our coffee time and Nancy doesn't have to do it all. This time I would like to invite Pastor Shannon to come forward and give us a summary of the CBOQ annual meeting, and also I believe there's a short video involved.
Yes, good morning and happy Father's Day. We do, you sent Dan and I to CBOQ assembly. It was just last weekend. And we thank you for that. There is a short, they put together a summary video of it. So it takes about 2 minutes. So I'd like to show that to you. And then I want to make some comments afterwards. So,
it is wonderful to be here with you. Welcome to Assembly 2022. We're so glad to be back together. It's wonderful to be here at Scarborough Chinese Baptist Church.
Scarborough Chinese Baptist Church was massive and they were so welcoming to us. So again, thank you for sending Dan and I to assembly as your delegates. Just so you know, you generously covered the cost of our hotel and registration, and we thank you for that. I was able to field some questions from CBOQ staff that I had, and we reconnected with a couple of couples from this association, and we met a couple of couples from other associations too. We also met friends of Avert and Anestes that were here last week with us, and people from London and Kitchener. And it was interesting, in our discussions, we are all wrestling with how to reach our communities and to be relevant within them. So that was almost reassuring for us. Dan and I attended separate workshops. His was on intergenerational outreach, and mine was entitled "It Takes a Church to Raise a Parent." And I'm so excited about that one, and I really want to follow up on it. All those workshops are on the CBOQ website, and Dan is going to link it onto ours as well if you wanted to check them out. The overriding scripture for assembly was taken from Isaiah 43:19, which says, "See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I am making a way in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland." As you saw on those banners, catchword themes for assembly were revive, renew, reconnect, resilience, remember, and reimagine. And just a reminder that CBOQ, Canadian Baptists of Ontario and Quebec, is a family of approximately 320 autonomous churches worshiping in 28 different languages. Member churches join local associations to work in local and global missions to further the gospel of Jesus, to be transformed by Christ, and to reveal God's kingdom to the world. During assembly, we welcomed, it was exciting to welcome two new churches, Stonebridge Baptist and Community on the Mount, and I believe they're both from Markham. Seven churches resigned last year, and we learned on Friday morning that our executive minister, Tim McCoy, he had contracted COVID. So he had tested positive Thursday night or Friday morning. And so he wasn't able to be there, so he wasn't able to explain what had happened with those seven churches that had resigned. Three churches closed. Strathaven and Monk churches within our association celebrated 150 years and 125 anniversary, respectively. So I did print out a copy of the business of the meeting booklet. It includes all this information that I've got and far more. I'll leave it at the back, and if anybody wants to borrow it, they're welcome to. And I can also email it to anyone who's interested, just to let you know. They are right now reviewing the core documents, including This We Believe, Baptist Distinctives, the Bylaw, Constitution, and the Covenant Agreement. And that's taking place now, and a resolution regarding a bylaw revision requiring assembly's approval will, it's suspected that it will be introduced at next year's assembly. During the business meeting, it came up again, and because it's a constant thing, right? The tension between our core documents that are descriptive or are they prescriptive? So because we're all autonomous, then there's a little bit of a tension there as to how far they go. Gordon, and just a couple more things. Gordon T. Smith was the plenary speaker, and he is the president and a professor at Ambrose University in Calgary, so it was nice to have a Canadian speaker. And he spoke on accepting one another, extending hospitality as a church, and listening to one another based on Romans 15:7. And as far as finances go, contributions from churches and individuals were approximately 1.3% lower than budget, but similar to last year. Total revenue at $2.5 million was 3.7% above budget and 8.9% below previous year. The deficiency of revenue over expenditures was $34,982, which they make up by transferring things from other places. And that's all I know. it's all in here if you want to take a closer look. The new CBOQ board president is Craig Rumble from Markham Baptist Church. And in the nomination report, I noticed that your former pastor, Pamela Fitkin, she has been serving on the strategic planning committee and will be retiring from that post next year. And the other thing I noticed was Reverend Williams has been serving Glamis Baptist Church for 30 or more years. And there was quite a list there. So thanks again for sending us. And if you have any further questions or would like emails of the documents, please let me know.
Thank you, Shannon. And a thank you to Dan and Shannon for generously giving of their time to attend assembly. At this time, I would like to lead you in a prayer of invocation. And as per usual, I will be stopping for a time of silent personal prayer. Shall we pray? Our Father who art in heaven, great is your faithfulness to us, your children. Your compassion, love, and grace to us is unchanging. This morning we pause to individually and silently confess our sins and ask a blessing on this service. Morning by morning, we see your love and grace for us displayed in nature all around us. We see the farmers doing their first cut of hay. We see the crops growing, the sunshine, the rain, the warm temperatures. They are all gifts from you. Lord, you are so merciful to us, and as we sing and absorb the words of "This is my Father's world," we pause to thank you for this planet we live on. That is a miracle in itself, created by you, just for us. Father, your wisdom is profound, and your understanding is vast, beyond our comprehension, and yet you lavish us with gifts of love. When we sing, "Nothing is too difficult for you," we remember that you are in control of this world. Therefore, we can rest in peace, for we know the final outcome will be the defeat of Satan and his host of angels. Be with Pastor Shannon as she brings and expounds on the message entitled, "Who is on Board?" found in John 6:15-24. We ask for the Holy Spirit to keep our thoughts and actions working towards always being on board with Jesus as we continually seek to become more like him. Father, hear us as we pray, sing, and receive your message. Help us to keep all of the blessing found in today's service in our minds, thoughts, and actions in the weeks ahead, because nothing, absolutely nothing, is too difficult for you, our Redeemer, Creator, our Almighty Lord, God, and Master. To you be all the glory and praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We ask you to stand as you are able for the three verses of number 143, "This is my Father's world."
My Father's word, and to my my Father's bliss. Oh, let me ne'er forget that though the wrong seems oft so strong, God is the
out in the parking lot, the vehicle stopped and said, are we welcome to come? And I said, oh yeah. And then said to her daughter, do you want to go to church? And her daughter said, oh yes. Isn't it wonderful to have that enthusiasm to want to come to church? Something we should all have when we wake up on Sunday mornings. This time I would like to offer a prayer for the offering that has been collected. Shall we pray? Father God, this is your world. And Lord, we thank you that you are in control of it. We thank you for everything we hear, we see, we touch. We thank you for every breath you give us. And Lord, we thank you for the offering that is being collected. We ask that you continue to use it for the upbuilding of this your church, for your church universal. We pray this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Our responsive reading is Job 9, verses 1 through 10, and I would like to lead you in the responsive reading at this time. Indeed, I know that this is true. Though they wish to dispute with him, his wisdom is profound, his power is vast. He moves mountains without their knowing it.
And overturns them in his hand.
He shakes the earth from its place.
And makes its pillars tremble.
He speaks to the sun, and it does not shine.
He seals off the light of the stars.
He alone stretches out the heavens.
And measures the waves of the sea.
He is the maker of the bear and the Orion. He performs wonders that cannot be fathomed. Amen. Reading that, and this was written so many years ago, and yet he stretches out the heavens. If he only knew how far the heavens stretched out, it would be amazing. Jeremiah 23:17 says, Lord, you made the heavens and the earth. Nothing is too hard for you. That is the basis for number 149. Ah, Lord God, and we ask you to stand as you are able.
By thy great power.
Please be seated. This time we will have the children's and seniors' moment all mixed together in one.
Well, I want to welcome you guys here. You have really, because we haven't seen you for so long, we really notice how much you've grown up. Wow. And I don't want you to tell me what you notice about me that's changed. So because we've had COVID and all that stuff, things have sort of changed here a little bit. Because we didn't have any kids like you guys, then I changed this to a senior's moment.
That's great.
So because today's Father's Day, there's some jokes I want to tell. Does your dad tell jokes? Do you tell your dad jokes?
Yeah.
Maybe if you listen, you can remember one joke that you like the best, and you can tell dad when you get home, okay? All right, see if you can, I hope there's one you like, because they're kind of silly jokes. And I wanted to remind you guys that there's cookies at the back. They're dad's cookies. So take some home for yourselves and take one home for dad too, okay? Because it's Father's Day, we have cookies for dad. So let me just continue here. Some dads are known or were known for their so bad that they're funny dad jokes. Seeing how it's Father's Day, I'd like to, like I said, share a few bad dad jokes that I found. And please feel free to groan. Why did the golfer bring two pairs of socks? In case he got a hole in one, of course. What did the ocean say to the beach? Nothing. It just waved. Where do you learn to make a banana split? Sunday school. Now that's a good one. When we get back to Sunday school, maybe that's something you can suggest. You have a banana split day. Why couldn't the bicycle stand up by itself? It was too tired. What does a bee use to brush its hair? A honeycomb. Have you ever tried to catch fog? F-O-G, fog. I tried yesterday, but I missed. What do you get from a pampered cow?
Boiled milk.
What do you call a pony with a sore throat?
A little horse.
Well done. Just a few more. How can you tell if a tree is a dogwood tree?
By its bark.
Yep, of course. Spring is here. I got so excited, I wet my plants. Why did the football coach go to the bank?
To get his quarterback.
Why can't a leopard hide?
Because he's always spotted.
Why did the orange lose the race?
It ran out of juice.
How can you fix a broken pumpkin?
With a pumpkin patch.
Two more to go. Or this is the third one here. Why did the man fall down the well? Because he couldn't see that well. Where do boats go? Maybe this is one you can remember. Where do boats go when they get sick? They go to the dock.
ears but cannot hear. A cornfield. I'm probably going to lose my good job after that. Perhaps your dad was known for his corny jokes. Perhaps you as a father are known for your corny jokes. And consider that an inheritance from your father. Sometimes we inherit physical traits from our fathers that are literally as plain as the noses on our faces. However, teaching children about the love and living hope found only through faith in Jesus, our risen Savior, is an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. May that be what we strive to give our children as an inheritance. Let us unite in prayer. Let us pray. Father, your word from Psalm 33 is our prayer today. And it says, no king is saved by the size of his army, no warrior escapes by his great strength. A horse is a vain hope for deliverance. Despite all its great strength, it cannot save. But the eyes of the Lord are on those who fear him, on those whose hope is in his unfailing love, to deliver them from death and keep them alive in famine. We wait in hope for you, Lord. You are our help and our shield. In you our hearts rejoice, for we trust in your holy name. May your unfailing love be with us, Lord, even as we put our hope in you. Help us to teach our children and their children's children about you as we spend time with them. Help us to pass on an inheritance of faith. In your mercy, Lord, write their names in your book of life. In the name of Jesus and in the presence of the Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen.
I invite Pastor Shannon to come forward and lead the rest of the service.
Thank you, boss. It is my privilege to lead us in prayer for our world and our community and ourselves. Please join me in prayer. Our Father everlasting, Lord Jesus, our crucified and risen Savior, Holy Spirit, our constant comforter, our triune God, you are the everlasting one. Our trust is in you. We gather as your created and redeemed image bearers to your glory. Lord, how great you are. You are our refuge and strength, a very present help in times of trouble. You alone are our good shepherd. In you there is life, life abundant. You lead us to green pastures and beside still waters. You restore our anxious and weary souls. Even in the darkest valleys, we will not fear, for you are right here with us. You are always attentive to us. You provide for us. You guide us. You watch behind us, and you go before us. We find safety, comfort, peace, and joy in your omnipotent and loving hands. Thank you for the precious gift of faith, which you, Father, have given us. May you increase our faith. May nothing separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. As your dependent yet expectant children, we come to you with humble hearts asking you, God, to continue to protect your church and your people as they serve you here and afar. Thank you that we were able to see Averett and Anesta last week. Bless them, the Susies, and all who serve you in foreign lands. Protect and encourage them. Thank you, Lord, for assembly last week, for the community of believers that are striving to serve and honor you. Grant the leadership of CBOQ wisdom that they may uphold your word. We pray for Bromley Baptist Church in Ottawa, our prayer partner church, and all churches. May they proclaim your truth with passion and purpose. May we function as we should in this world, sharing the gospel, baptizing believers, making disciples, and following your commands, Jesus. Restrictions are lifting regarding COVID, but Lord, there are still hundreds of people in intensive care in this province and people needing help all over the world. Renew the energies of the medical staff, the emergency and support staffs. Keep them safe and strong. We ask for your attentive presence and merciful care on the most vulnerable among us, those most physically vulnerable, emotionally vulnerable, and economically vulnerable. Give us wisdom as we strive to serve you, God, by serving them. Help us to serve compassionately in your name, to your honor. We pray for those among us who are grieving. We ask for your comfort and peace to rest upon all who are mourning the loss of a loved one. We bring before you, Lord, Irene, Mary Weir's family, the Wright family, and all who are missing someone. For those who are suffering physically, who are awaiting surgery, healing after surgery, for those who need support and assistance, Lord, we ask for your intervention. Give doctors and specialists your insights that they may accurately diagnose and treat what ails those who are suffering. Heal us, Lord. Forgive us. Forgive us for the many ways we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. Work through us that your name would be glorified. Help us to joyfully and sacrificially be the eyes, ears, hands, and feet of Jesus to each other and to our neighbors. Bless the churches and the plans we make for a vacation Bible camp for the children in this community this summer. Help us to be the workers in your harvest, that faith in you would be the inheritance passed on from generation to generation. And as Jesus taught us to pray, let us pray our Lord's Prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Today's message is based on John chapter 6, verses 15 to 24. Hear the word of God. Jesus, knowing that they intended to come and make him king by force, withdrew again to a mountain by himself. When evening came, his disciples went down to the lake, where they got into a boat and set off across the lake for Capernaum. By now it was dark, and Jesus had not yet joined them. A strong wind was blowing, and the waters grew rough. When they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus approaching the boat, walking on the water. Excuse me, and they were frightened. But he said to them, "It is I, don't be afraid." Then they were willing to take him into the boat, and immediately the boat reached the shore where they were heading. The next day, the crowd that had stayed on the opposite shore of the lake realized that only one boat had been there, and that Jesus had not entered it with his disciples, but that they had gone away alone. Then some boats from Tiberias landed near the place where the people had eaten the bread after the Lord had given thanks. Amen. Before I begin, please join me in prayer.
Heavenly Father, we shouldn't do anything but first pray. And Lord, this morning I pray that you would bless what is spoken here, that it would be your truth, and that it would be to our good. Through Jesus I pray. Amen. And sorry, I forgot one verse. Once the crowd realized that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they got into the boats and went to Capernaum in search of Jesus. Who is familiar with or has one of these suctioned cupped alerts that are usually stuck to a car's rear or side windows? The original baby on board sign produced by Michael Lerner's company called Safety First was designed to warn fellow drivers that an infant was in their midst. The idea being that drivers would be a little more careful around a vehicle displaying the sign, either because of the precious cargo or that a fatigued or distracted parent was at the wheel of the car ahead of them. In the summer of 1985, barely a year after its debut, the baby on board sign had been affixed to more than 3 million cars, with 500,000 being sold each month. By 2014, company owners estimated more than 10 million signs had been sold. Of course, now, other manufacturers have cutesied up the same message with graphics and even more specific details like twins on board. For those who don't have a baby on board but would still like others to drive carefully and courteously around them, there's the option of displaying this sign, warning of a former baby on board. As those babies get a little older and have babies, you can proudly display these ones that signal there are grandchildren on board and or that there are proud grandparents on board. Of course. Then there are those in their cynicism who grumpily proclaim, "Who cares who's on board?" Well, caring about who's on board is the topic of our study in today's reading from the Gospel of John. And if there's any doubt, I want to remind us that God cares who's on board with him. For he wants all of us on board, in his boat, so to speak. God, our Savior, who wants all people to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. All people, from every nation. It tells us that in the New Testament book of 1 Timothy, but we see the glorious future through the vision God gave John, which he recorded in the book of Revelation. And we see in that book of God's revelation of the end times that a great multitude that no one could count from every nation, tribe, people, and language were standing before the throne and before the Lamb. They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands. And they cried out in loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." This is a glorious sight. Every nation, tribe, people, and language proclaimed that salvation belongs to God. The Bible tells us that their robes were made white in the blood of the Lamb. They were made white, they were purified and sanctified and considered righteous before God because they turned from ways and thinking and attitudes and behaviors and deeds that were not pure and sanctified and righteous before God. They repented of those old ways, those decisions and attitudes dictated by the flesh and they turn from them because those ways are death and darkness and eternal suffering. That great multitude repented of what was wrong within them and turned to trust in Jesus, the risen Redeemer, for by faith he sanctifies his people. When scriptures tell us that repentance and faith in Jesus as the Son of God who died for our sins and was raised from the dead by the power of God sanctifies us, that means we are blessed. We are approved. We are purified. We are consecrated. We are on board with him, whether the waters are calm or stormy. And his people, those who love and trust and obey him, are holy because the Lord whom they worship, the Lord whom we worship, is holy. Jesus, the Prince and King, urges us to be perfect. Therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. And that is a tall order. But Jesus promises to be with us to the end of the age, so he can walk with us. And what a world it would be if we were all distracted from our old ways because we are seeking to be obedient to the direction of his Holy Spirit within us. What a vision is this great multitude that no one could count from every nation that is described in God's revelation. I want you to notice something, though. Even though this is a great multitude that no one could count, it was like a sea of people. The Bible, God's inspired word, does not say it was all people from every nation, tribe, people, and language. It says they were from every nation, tribe, people, and language. These are God's representatives, his delegates, that trusted in him, that proclaimed him as Savior. Though God wants all people to be saved, even though all people have sinned against him in thought and in word and in deed, we see that that does not happen. Revelation warns in that new heaven and new earth, nothing impure will ever enter it, nor will anyone who does what is shameful or deceitful, but only those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. So you see how important it is, with what urgency we must get people on board in realizing there is one God and one mediator between God and mankind, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all people. So you see how important it is, with what urgency we must prayerfully and obediently go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything Jesus has commanded. I say prayerfully because we need to ask for God's mercy, that he would open the eyes of the blind, that he would drop the scales off their eyes and open their hearts to him. He gives us a choice, just like hopefully each one of us who has children have cut the apron strings and allowed our children to make their own choices. Even though God wants all people to be saved, there remain stiff-necked people whose hearts and ears are still uncircumcised, resisting the Holy Spirit. This quote from Acts was boldly issued by Stephen in front of the Sanhedrin before they stoned him. Calling them stiff-necked was a term God frequently used to describe the Israelites. It's a term he uses for us. And the Israelites were well aware of its agrarian roots, this term, stiff-necked. For when they plowed the land, the plow was usually drawn by two oxen. As the plowman required one hand to guide the plow, he carried in the other an ox goad, really a stick with a spike on it. With this, he would prick the oxen upon the hind legs to increase their speed and upon the neck to turn or to keep a straight course if they deviated. So if an ox was hard to control or stubborn, it was known as being hard of neck or stiff-necked. Hence, the figure was used in the scriptures to express the stubborn, obstinate spirit of a people not responsive to the guiding of their God. So then, as there is now, there are stiff-necked people who choose to ignore our Heavenly Father's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature, which have been clearly seen and understood. Even as we're driving up today, Dan says, you know, as we drive up here and we see all this around us, he says, I don't understand how people can say there is no God. People ignore what they were taught as a child. They ignore invitations. They ignore these big church buildings. More tragically, most tragically, stiff-necked people ignore Jesus. Or they want to categorize him as something less than whom he is. The first verse in our scripture reading for today, and I know we included it last week in our reading, but it's our first scripture today. And in it, it explains Jesus knowing that they had just fed the 5,000 men plus their families. And Jesus, knowing that they intended to come and make him king by force, withdrew again to a mountain by himself. These people who had been able to witness the miracles and healings Jesus had performed, perhaps some of them had personally benefited from them. Some of them had just been fed by him. They knew what it was to be healed by the Messiah. The Bible says that this crowd of people intended to come and make him king by force, to make him a political king of the land. Making Jesus king of the Israelites was a far lesser calling than that which the Lord had planned. Jesus was to be and is more than a great prophet, an earthly king, a political Messiah. His titles include that of Savior, a wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. Jesus will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness. Amen. So because Jesus knew that this crowd of people who had been healed by him and fed by him and saw the signs he performed, because he knew they intended to make him king by force, Jesus withdrew again to a mountain by himself. Scripture goes on to say that when evening came, his disciples went down to the lake where they got into a boat and set off across the lake for Capernaum. Capernaum is a few miles to the north of Tiberias. So at the bottom, I don't know if I can do this. Do I have to?
A little bit at the very top.
There it is. Okay, so there's Tiberias, about where they were, and Capernaum is up here. So this is the Sea of Galilee, of course, and so they were in about the middle of the sea when today's reading happened. When evening came, his disciples went down, they got in the boat, and they set off for Capernaum. And as I pointed out, you can see where Capernaum is compared to where they were. So it was now dark, and the disciples, in obedience to Jesus, were returning to Capernaum without him. To Jesus and the disciples, Capernaum wasn't just a place to go. According to the Jewish virtual library, it was where Jesus and several disciples lived during much of his ministry. According to historians, Capernaum was abandoned in the 7th century and rediscovered through archaeology. There, underneath a modern church, are 5th and 4th century churches and the 1st century house where Peter lived. So as evening came, Jesus' disciples went down to the lake, where they got into a boat and set off across the lake for Capernaum. By now, as I mentioned, it was dark and Jesus had not yet joined them. A strong wind was blowing and the waters grew rough. And I want to interject here with a little geography lesson. And I don't know if you can see in the picture, up here, that's the Mediterranean Sea. And they've tried to show you the difference in the sea levels. The lake, the Sea of Galilee, is set in the hills of northern Israel, and it's nearly 700 feet below sea level. It's nearly 8 miles wide at its widest point and more than 12 miles long from north to south. In places, the sea plunges to depths of 200 feet. Around the sea, you can partly see the hills of Galilee reaching nearly 1,400 feet above sea level, and the mountains of the Golan Heights, called the Decapolis in Jesus' time, reached more than 2,500 feet in height. The sea's location, and of course God's purposes, makes it subject to sudden and violent storms as the wind comes over the eastern mountains and drops suddenly onto the sea. This was the situation. This was where the disciples found themselves. They had rowed about 3 or 4 miles across the lake. Jesus was on the mountainside praying, and a strong wind was blowing, and the waters were getting rough. Sometimes problems catch us by surprise, don't they? And here we have a testament to the fact that the lives of Jesus' disciples then as now, as I'm sure most, if not all of us, can attest to, our lives are not necessarily an uninterrupted course of prosperity and happiness, or a constant string of fair weather and miracles. Here were Jesus' disciples in a boat, vulnerable, bobbing around in the middle of the Sea of Galilee, fighting the elements between 3 and 6 in the morning. Perhaps they felt as if Jesus had abandoned them. Perhaps there have been times when you and I have felt like we were on our own in the early hours of the day. However, look what happens. Now remember, this experience was also recorded in the Gospels of Matthew and Mark. And when we piece them together, we discover that it was shortly before dawn. It was still dark, and Mark tells us the wind was against them, and that Jesus saw the disciples straining at the oars. So Jesus goes to them. Matthew and Mark both say that the disciples thought he was a ghost, and they were terrified. Even in John's account, he notes that they were frightened when they saw someone approaching the boat walking on the water. When they saw the figure whom they later recognized as Jesus walking on the sea and coming near the boat, they were frightened. They didn't know it was Jesus. They thought it was an apparition and they were afraid. This physical manifestation of the deity of Jesus is confirmed when he reassures them, saying, "It is I, do not be afraid." Jesus spoke this in a way that the disciples would recognize him. But when we look at the original Greek, what Jesus says is, "I am, fear not." Jesus Christ is the great I am. It is the personal name of God. God said to Moses, "I am who I am." And he said, "Say this to the people of Israel, I am has sent me to you." On several occasions, it is recorded that Jesus used that I am in attesting to his deity. 7 times in the Gospel of John, Jesus asserts his divinity, claiming to be the great I am. The great I am, the only one who can meet man's greatest needs in life. Jesus, as we heard last Sunday, fed 5,000 men and declared, "I am the bread of life." He alone is able to satisfy the greatest spiritual hunger in our lives. There is no other way to have life. And to avoid spiritual starvation, we need to go to him daily and eat that bread of life. Jesus said, "I am the light of the world." He healed a blind man groping in the darkness and then opened his spiritual eyes so he could see the great I am and worship him. If you are wandering around in a spiritual darkness, know that Jesus is the only light you need to guide you into God's holy presence. Jesus said, "I am the door. All other doors lead down the wrong path into eternal destruction. Jesus is the only entrance into eternal life." Jesus said, "I am the good shepherd. Every individual is like a wandering, stray, lost lamb caught in the briars of sin. There are a lot of false shepherds herding up stray sheep to take to slaughter. Jesus is the only good shepherd. He takes you and me by the hand into the Father's presence, and he feeds us when we repent and proclaim his lordship. Jesus conquered death. Not only did he say, "I am the resurrection and life," but he rose from the dead to prove it. In fact, this is the great evidence that Jesus is the great I am that I am. He died, was buried, and 3 days later rose from the dead. He is alive. He is our hope in the face of death. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Only God can claim that. No guru, no I am, no priest, no Buddha, no Muhammad, no pastor, no person can claim to be savior to our salvation and hope other than Jesus, the risen Son of God Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. Furthermore, Jesus sustains our spiritual life because he is the true vine, the only way, the giver of life. Jesus said, "I am the true vine." When Jesus told the frightened disciples who were struggling against the storm in that boat, "It is I am he," they were willing to take him into the boat. When they recognized Jesus for whom he was, when they recognized him as God, as the Word through whom all things were made, in whom was life and light, they invited him in. They reached their destination. And did you notice that as soon as they recognized him and invited him on board, the Bible says that immediately the boat reached the shore where they were heading. And it begs the question, what will you do with the great I am? Will you, have you invited Jesus on board with you? The Messiah, the one who died for your sins and my sins, the great I am, who won victory over death, who rose from the dead by the power of God. Claim him as your Lord and worship him today. For God our Savior wants all people to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. That is the desired destination that our Heavenly Father wants for all of us. May he have mercy upon us and open our eyes in faith to his salvation. Amen. Let us pray. Father, you are goodness and mercy. You are gracious and forgiving. We depend upon your desire to see us saved. Lord, for without you we have no hope or future. There is nothing we can do to earn your peace, and that's why there should be no end or depth to our joy and thanksgiving, for you have blessed us with faith in your risen Son, Jesus, our Redeemer. We praise you, the great I am, for you have blessed us beyond all we could hope for. Forgive us our sins and let us live anew in you. In the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior, we pray. Amen. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is God's faithfulness indeed. Please join me in singing our final hymn. Stand as you're able.
All I have need.
good sometimes to have a different version and a slower version to make us think about the words and stay alert. Just a reminder before I close with a final benediction that there will be no coffee time today after church. Have a happy Father's Day, and please wish those men in your life a happy Father's Day, and please take the cookies at the back with you. Let me leave you with this benediction. May the strength of God pilot you. May the wisdom of God instruct you. May the hand of God protect you. May the word of God direct you this day and forevermore. Amen.